So in the previous lecture, we essentially discussed the existence and uniqueness theorem. So whenever we are given initial value problem dy by dx equals to fxy, where the initial condition is yx naught is equals to y naught is given, and around the point, so essentially we are looking for a solution of the function of the differential equation of the initial value problem around the point x naught y naught, right? So this solution yx, we are looking in this rectangle R, which is a small enough interval around the point x naught y naught. So whether such solution yx exists of the initial value problem or not. So we discussed the existence and uniqueness theorem. The existence means for the existence, we need this function fxy is to be continuous in the given rectangle, and the solution exists in this particular interval, right? We know how to find this alpha, and then the solution is unique if f as well as its partial derivative with respect to y both are the continuous in at all points in the rectangle, right? So the second condition has nothing to do with alpha or this interval. The second condition over all points in the rectangle. So then we discuss the weaker condition, which is known as the Lipschitz condition. So you can see that if the partial derivative of the function f with respect to y exists, that means we can take here limit, right? If del f by del y is continuous means it is bounded. So that means what is this quotient? This quotient, whenever we take limit y1 goes to y2, this is nothing but the partial derivative, right? So whenever partial derivative exists and it is bounded, Lipschitz condition automatically is satisfied, right? So therefore Lipschitz condition is a weaker condition in which we don't assume that this limit exists. Limit y1 tends to y2 of this quotient exists. So therefore it is weaker condition. We have seen one example of where we applied the existence uniqueness theorem, as well as we found the solution directly also, and we have checked that whether the solution exists or not. So in this case, we have seen that the solution exists. That is 10x, and from existence uniqueness theorem also we are able to conclude that the solution is unique in the smaller interval, right? But actually if you find the solution, then it exists over the larger interval in terms of pi by 2. And in the second example, we have seen that this partial derivative is not continuous at zero, and there are points in this rectangle, for example 1 comma 0, which has y coordinate 0, right? Therefore this partial derivative is not continuous over the all points in the rectangle, right? So that is what we discussed, that we can't conclude the uniqueness here, but later on we find the solution, and we have seen that the two method gives two different solutions of this equation. So that means the solution is actually not unique, right? That is, we are able to conclude. And then we discuss that Lipschitz condition is also not satisfied here. So this is what we discussed in the previous lecture. One more example we want to discuss regarding existence and uniqueness. So here we want to find the essentially the what are the all points around which we can have a solution. So discuss. The existence and uniqueness of the solution Just a minute. Solution of the initial value problem, which is given to be dy by dx is equals to 2y by x, and that is given to be y of x naught is y naught. So here the question is that we are not given actually the initial condition, right? That is arbitrary initial condition is given. So we need to identify for which values of x naught and y naught the solution exists, and for which value of x naught and y naught among the solution exists, whether it is unique or infinite, right? The solution is unique or infinitely many. So we know that there are two methods to identify these. First method is by applying the existence and uniqueness theorem, and second method is finding the solution directly. So let us first apply the existence and uniqueness theorem for this particular example and identify for which values of x naught and y naught the solution exists, solution of this initial value problem exists. So for existence and uniqueness, we know that for the theorem we need to find first fxy, that is right side of the differential equation in the form dy by dx is equal to something. So that something is 2y by x, and therefore what will be the partial derivative? Partial derivative will be 2 divided by x, partial derivative of this function with respect to y. So x variable is constant, so therefore its derivative is 2y by x. So now we can see that whenever the denominator is zero, the function will be unbounded or discontinuous. So denominator is in terms of x, right? Denominator is zero, that means x is zero. So whenever the x coordinate is zero in the condition x naught y naught, the function f will not be continuous. Right, if f is not continuous, that means the solution does not exist, right? So depending on whether the x coordinate is zero or not, we will have two cases. So first case, let us see when the solution exists. So first case, we are considering the denominator, the point x naught y naught we are choosing such that we will have the denominator non-zero. So that will give us case number one, x naught is zero, or in terms of the initial condition, x naught is non-zero point. So if we are given a rectangle, x naught, y naught, a point x naught, y naught, which is where x naught is not zero. So we can see that since x naught is non-zero, we can always find a small enough rectangle around this point which does not contain any point for which x naught is zero. Right. So let's write down this clearly. We can find small enough rectangle or around the point x naught y naught. So basically, we are considering x naught is non zero such that both the functions, because both these function contains the denominator term to be x, right? F as well as del x y, del f by del y. So f as well as del f by del y, both these functions are continuous in this small enough rectangle R, right? And we know that whenever f as well as del f by del y are continuous functions in R. Therefore, there exists unique solution. Exists in this case in the interval x minus x naught less than alpha. So here we cannot determine alpha, so we'll just write down it as minimum of a and b by m, right? So in this case we got unique solution. So when we get unique solution, whenever x naught is non-zero, so for example the point 1, 0 in which x naught is 1, so there we have a unique solution. So let us see about case number 2. So case number 2 is we have a initial condition x naught y naught in which x naught is 0. So in the first case, there is no role of y naught, but clearly y naught must satisfy the initial condition, right? This must be satisfied, whatever y naught we take, right? So in bracket, we can write that y naught is f of x naught. y of x naught. So explicitly we are not saying what is the solution here, we are just saying there exists a solution. And on the other hand, whenever we take x naught is 0, so we can see that since f is not continuous, in any interval, any rectangle, around x naught, y naught. So if x naught is 0, whatever you take point, x naught is 0 means it is on the y axis, right? So if you are in the y axis and you have a point on the y axis, we can never find a rectangle, let us say 1, 0, we cannot find a rectangle such that it doesn't contain point on y axis. It will always contain a point, that rectangle always contain a point on the y axis. That means y coordinate will be x coordinate, yeah. So basically it will not be sorry so x is 0, right? X is 0 means it is on the y axis, so it will be 0, 1, right? So if we have a point here, that means in this rectangle, whatever small enough rectangle we take around the point 0, 1, there will always be a point in that rectangle which has x coordinate 0. So that means we cannot apply the existence and uniqueness theorem. So we can't apply existence and uniqueness theorem. So one case we discuss x naught not 0, but x naught equals to 0, we are not getting any information from the existence and uniqueness theorem. So now what shall we do? We will try to find the exact solution of the given differential equation. So whether the solution directly we can find from the differential equation in this case. So we know that the given differential equation which is dy by dx equals to 2y divided by x is of the separable variable form. and we can check that. Its solution is, so we can easily solve it, and solution, you can verify that it is c times x square, where c is a constant. So now we got the solution directly by solving the differential equation. So next, what we want to check is, we want to check the initial condition when our x naught is zero, right? So whenever x naught is zero, what we'll get is, for x naught is equals to zero, we get y naught is equals to y of x naught, which is y of zero. Y of zero is zero, right? So therefore, when we take y naught is zero, in that case, the solution yx is equals to cx square satisfies the initial condition. For each c. So that means we have so many solutions for different values of c. Right. So that means what we get is, we get, in this case, we get infinite many solutions. Yeah, and on the other hand, when we take x naught is zero and y naught is not equal to zero, then in this case we get no solution, right? Because such a condition is not satisfied by any of this curve. So that, therefore, we get no solution. So essentially, we have checked all the cases here. You can also discuss by this solution the first case also, that is, whenever we have x naught non-zero. But that we already got, that whenever x naught is non-zero, we will get the unique solution when it satisfies this condition, f x naught is y naught. Yeah, so this is one example which I wanted to discuss regarding the Picard's existence and uniqueness theorem. Now, one last method we want to discuss for the first order differential equation is method of variation of parameter. For first order ordinary differential equation. So we know that so for first order, actually linear ordinary differential equation. So we have used integrating factor method to solve the first order linear differential equation. But we need this method also to identify certain method of differential equation. So let us start with that. Consider the first order linear ODE. So that is dy by dx plus dxy is equals to qx. So this linear differential equation of first order is given. What this method says that first we can solve this differential equation by considering qx equals to 0. That means we will solve the corresponding homogeneous differential equation, and then we will find the solution of the whole differential equation. So first consider the corresponding linear homogeneous coordinate differential equation, which is dy by dx plus pxy is equal to 0. So this is the simplest differential equation. We can solve it using separable variable form. So therefore, essentially we get solution to be y is equal to e power minus integration px dx. Right. So this is our function yx. So here, so let me call this equation number 2. So here star is the solution of homogeneous equation. So what is the special thing in the solution? The solution is constant times e power minus integration px dx. So this says that suppose we assume that our solution, so this solution of homogeneous part, so is it possible that the solution of the non-homogeneous equation, that is the equation 1, has the solution y is equal to v times this function, where v is some function which we will determine later. So let us check whether it is possible. So suppose yx is equal to vx e power is a solution of equation 1. So we are not saying vx we can find always, but it turns out that in this particular method we can actually find vx. All right, so that we'll see later. So first we are assuming, suppose that yx is equal to vx times this is a solution of equation number 1. So it is a solution, that means we can substitute y in the differential equation, y dash in this differential equation, and y and y dash satisfies equation number 1. Let us first find out what is y dash. Y dash in this example will be v dash e power minus integration px dx minus v times px e power minus integral px dx. Right. So just we have differentiated this function and we got minus of px. So that we substituted here. Right. So now we got y dash. So let us substitute both of these in the original linear non-homogeneous differential equation. So substituting y and y dash in equation 1, we get certain equation. So what is that equation? Let us write down that. So our equation is dy by dx plus pxy. So dy by dx is v dash e power minus px dx minus vpx e power minus px dx plus px y. So that is px times y. What is y? Y is v times e power integral minus px dx. Is equals to qx, right? So this is what the we just substituted in differential equation one. So now you can see that the second and third terms are same with the alternating sign plus and minus. So therefore these both terms will cancel out, and finally what we get is we get v dash is equals to this term we can take on the other side. So we get ex e power positive power px dx, and then we can integrate this equation to get the vx function. So vx is turns out to be integral of this function. So that is essentially integral of qx e power integral qx dx plus constant of integration, right? So this is our vx. So you can see now that first we assume that vx times this function is a solution, and then substitute, assuming that that is a solution that satisfies equation one. Using equation one, we got the actual value of v function. So we determined v. So finally, the final solution is yx is equal to e power minus px dx times t plus integral qx e power px dx is the solution of the given non-homogeneous first order differential equation. So let us see one example where we will find out what will be v function also. So here we want to solve the first order differential equation dy by dx plus 2xy is equals to 4x using method of variation of parameter. So we already know how to solve first order linear equations using integrating factor, but why we are discussing this method? Because this variation of parameter method we will also be using in the second order differential equations. So essentially we want to we are studying this particular method of solving given differential equation, whether it is first order or second order. So for instance, we are working with first order. Later on, we'll see how to solve the second order using this method. So first of all, we shall solve dy by dx plus 2xy is equals to 0, homogeneous part. So homogeneous part we can solve using separable variable. So that will turns out to be when we integrate we get so let me write down the solution directly. So therefore the solution is yx is equals to constant times e power minus x square, right? Yeah, so this is a solution. That means we shall assume that yx equals to vx times the function e power minus x square is solution of the given non-homogeneous linear ODE, right? Yeah, so again here we need to find first what is y dash. So y dash will be v dash e power minus x square minus 2x v times e power minus x square. All right, so this is the derivative of y function. So let us now substitute y and y dash in given ODE. So we'll get the equation. So first we'll substitute y dash, that is v dash e power minus x square minus 2xv e power minus x square plus px times v. So that px times v, that term is plus 2xy, right? So plus 2xy means plus 2x, and y is vx e power minus x square is equals to, right hand side is 4 times x. And then we know these two terms will cancel out. So v dash is 4x e power minus x square. Just integrate it, we'll get vx function. So derivative of e power minus x square is 2x e power minus x square. That means the integral is 2 times e power minus x square plus constant. Right. So this is the v term. And therefore, the final solution is yx is equals to vx times e power minus x square. So essentially, this is 2 plus 2 times plus 2.
So that would be 4x e power x square, no? Not minus.
Yes. 4x e power minus x square, yes. Yeah, so what we use here is because this is derivative of e power minus x square is minus 2x e power minus x square.
So in previous step, it will be v dash 4x e power x square, not minus x square.
E power x square. Okay, let me check that. Yes, you are right. So we have taken x square on the other side, correct? So you are right. So there is a mistake of sign. So then it would be plus, would be also plus. So is it fine now? Just check it once.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so you are right. So we have taken e power minus x square on the other side. That means for x square, we will get on the right side. And then it is correct that our function y, in that we have the term e power minus x square. So essentially, these two terms will cancel out. We get constant 2, and this is the solution. Right. Okay. So this is okay. Yeah. So this is one method which we wanted to discuss regarding the separable of variable method. So now we are moving to the second order ordinary differential equations. And again, we'll in the second. So in this course, we'll study mostly solving second order differential equations. First order, we already have discussed lots of methods. The question is, which method of first order differential equation we can use in the second order differential equation? So the answer is not every method. All right. So all the methods, whatever we studied, not all the methods we can extend to the second order differential equation. So which methods we will use to extend in the second order and higher order differential equation? So that now we will study, and essentially we will not discuss the third order and so on. We will mostly focus on the second order, and the higher order methods is more or less similar to the second order differential equation. How to solve the second order differential equation. So we'll now on focus on the second order differential equation. And whatever methods works for solving the second order differential equation, they also work for the higher order differential equation. So Picard's method has not only his importance for the existence and uniqueness theorem, Picard's iteration theorem, but one of the important thing to observe in the Picard iteration is that the solution what we are getting here, if you remember, we got a solution using Picard iteration is e power minus x. And e power minus x, we solve using the power series. So Picard's iteration methods gives us a hint that a solution of given differential equation can be of the form power series. So in this previous method, what we assume is yx is certain function, which is bx times some function, and we applied to differential equation and we evaluated this function vx. The same way later on we'll find the solution of the second order differential equation, which is of the form power series. So we will assume certain power series is a solution, and then we'll determine what are the constants there, and that we will find the function. So first of all, let us see what is the standard form of the second order differential equation. So the simplest one is the linear differential equation. So px y double dash plus qx y dash plus rx y is equals to c times x, where x is in some interval. Such a differential equation is called second order. So this is second order differential equation, but it is more or less looking like first order linear differential equation, right? But here we have second derivative also, therefore it is known as second order linear differential equation. And again, in this case, we have homogeneous and non-homogeneous equation. So whenever we have cx is identically zero function, that means for all values of x it is zero, then the equation is, this linear equation is called homogeneous. Otherwise, it is called non-homogeneous. And whenever we have y1 and y2, two solutions of this differential equation, then y1 plus y2 is also solution of this differential equation, and some number times y1 is also solution of this differential equation. So that means the solution of this differential equation forms a subspace of continuous functions. So here we are assuming this px, qx, rx and cx are continuous functions. So let me write down here px, qx, rx and cx are continuous functions. On the interval I, right? So they are continuous functions, as well as the set of all solutions of the homogeneous differential equation. So homogeneous means we have px y dash y double dash plus qx y dash plus rx y is equals to zero. So this is homogeneous second order linear differential equation. the set of solution is called solution space. So that means it is a subspace of vector space of continuous functions, and therefore it is a itself a vector space. So basically what we are saying is y1, if y1 and y2 are solution, then y1 plus y2 as well as some number times y1 is also solution of the equation. So these are essentially the properties of the subspace. Yeah. So we know that now we know that the solution space we have, and whenever we have a solution space, we can discuss in the solution space linear dependence, linear independence, and kind of basis and all these things, right? So the first question is, when we say that if we have a two solution of second order linear equation, when it is dependent and when it is independent. So this notion is defined very similarly as in the vector space case. So let I be an interval in the real line, and if we have two functions f and g from I to R, which are continuous, so we say that f and g are linearly dependent . So we know what is the definition. Definition is whenever we take alpha x plus beta y is 0, and then if alpha beta both are 0, then it is independent, otherwise it is dependent. So dependent, we know that one of the alpha or beta should be non-zero, right? So there are real numbers, you can call it alpha and beta, for A and B, not both zero, such that the equation is satisfied. Alpha times first vector, so vector here is a function, continuous function. Another function is g. So f and g are solution basically. So in this definition, we are not discussing f and g are solutions. We are just considering f and g are continuous functions. So in the vector space of continuous function, what do we mean by linearly dependent? That means this. And solution space is subspace of continuous functions. So even in the solution case, whenever we consider linearly dependence, that means this. And whenever the functions are not dependent, they are independent. Yeah. So independent means whenever alpha f plus beta g is 0 for every t in the every point in the interval, implies alpha and beta is 0. Right? Yeah, so if I write something wrong, please let me know any typo or anything. Yeah, so now the next thing is, we know that whenever in linear algebra we have checked that two functions are linearly dependent or independent, we have used determinants, right? because essentially determinants are used to determine rank also. So in this case also we are going to use certain determinants, but this determinants is in terms of vector, which vectors are functions here. So this determinant is known as Wronskian. So we are given two functions which are continuous. What do we mean by it's Wronskian? So let us see that. If we have two functions y1 and y2, continuously differentiable functions. On an interval I, which is a subset of real line, then for all x, for every point x in the interval, we define Wronskian of the functions y1 and y2 at a point x to be determinant of y1x, y2x. The second row is its derivative, right? Derivative of the function y1 and y2. So this w is known as Wronskian. So let me take one example of this Wronskian, and so basically whenever the Wronskian is non-zero, we say that the given functions are independent, and whenever it is zero, we say that it is dependent. So let us first find the Wronskian for two functions. First function is cos x function and second function is sin x function. And we are not determining what interval we are taking. Let us see. Let us take an arbitrary interval and see whether we can find the solution. So usually every time we will not write this x, right? We just write Wronskians of y1 and y2 to be determinant of y1, y2, y1 dash, y2 dash. So simply we'll write Wronskian of y1, y2 to be y1, y2, y1 dash, y2 dash. Our function y1 is cosine x, y2 is sine x, derivative of y1 is sin x function, minus of sin x, and derivative of sin x is cos x function. Okay. And then we will find this determinant, then it will be cos square x plus sin square x. Right, so you can see that the Wronskian, what we are getting is getting it in terms of x, where x is in the interval, but for every x, cos square x plus sin square x is 1. Right? So for this particular example, we are getting the value is 1 for every point in the interval, for whatever interval we take. So Wronskian is non-zero whenever the functions are cos x and sin x. And at the point where Wronskian is non-zero, the functions are independent. Yeah, so independent and dependence we'll discuss maybe in the next lecture. Yeah, so let me stop here today.